मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज आवर सेकंड चैप्टर ऑफ आवर सिलेबस कैरेक्टराइजेशन ऑफ बायोडायवर्सिटी. इन दिस चैप्टर वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द इंट्रोडक्शन, द नीड ऑफ कैरेक्टराइजेशन, वेरियस डिसिप्लिन्स ऑफ बायोडायवर्सिटी, देयर इज जेनेटिक डायवर्सिटी, स्पेसीज डायवर्सिटी एंड द इकोसिस्टम डायवर्सिटी, एज वेल एज इन दिस चैप्टर वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द कंसेप्ट ऑफ एंडेमिज्म एंड फाइटोजियोग्राफी. The characterization of biodiversity deals with the identification of various types of morphological characters, and the basis of these morphological features we can characterize the species either in different types of families or in orders or in groups. So this is why the characterization is essential, and in characterization we just have to observe the morphological features. So the characterization involves two main processes. One is observation and second one is the characterization. So in observations, whenever we come across any type of plant species, we can observe the different types of morphological features of the plant, maybe the habit, that is the plant is classified or characterized as tree species, maybe shrub or maybe herbs. And in general, we then discuss various types of morphological characters, like the characters of stem, then characters of leaf, what type of leaf is there, what type of inflorescence is there, and what type of different types of flowers, and in flowers we can observe the calyx, corolla, ambrosium and gynosium. So on the basis of these different types of observations we can characterize the species in particular group, maybe in the family or maybe in the order. We can characterize that species and we can place that species in that particular group on the basis of these different types of characteristics. Maybe there is variation in different types of ecosystem, and on the basis of variation in the ecosystem the species may show some morphological distinctiveness, and this is also the character which we can use for characterization, or we can use for differentiation of the species. Similarly, the morphological characterization is one part, and quantification of variation within and between them. So quantification, that means we can most of the times in description of plant species we can quantify the different parts, that is number of calyx, number of corolla, number of petals, number of sepals, number of stamens and number of carpels. So that on the basis of that we can also distinguish the species. There may be some genetic distances in the species. The height of the plant is one character. So quantitative characters, height of the plant may be different, maybe the number of leaves, number of flowers. So these are different types of characteristics, and also we will try to find out some relatedness. So when we classify, when we characterize one species on the basis of morphological characters, we can find out that there is some similarities in the morphological structures, and on the basis of these similarities we can put that a particular species in the particular group. So this is why the characterization is essential. Now in the characterization, in this chapter we are going to discuss about the different disciplines of biodiversity, that is the species diversity, genetic diversity and ecosystem diversity. So as we all know that there is a lot of variation in the species structure or species diversity. So in similar morphological features the species may show some distinctiveness, and on the basis of this that the species are classified. Also the species diversity is related with the diversity or variation among the species, number of species or number of different types of species which occur in that particular area. So this species diversity is basic level species diversity, because there are number of species, n number of species distributed throughout the world, and these different these variations may be the geomorphological variation, may be the variation is because of different types of ecosystems. It includes all the species ranging from plant to different microorganisms. So in any particular ecosystem, if you observe the number of species, the plant species, the animal species, the microbe species, the insects are there, invertebrates are so. So these are the number of different types of groups of living organism, and these groups are also surviving in the unit area. And it is also true that no two individuals of the same species are exactly similar. So this is what is the species diversity. In genetic diversity, this diversity is related with the genetic resources in the organism. For example, the DNA structure or genes which are present in the species, these genes are responsible for adaptations, or these genes are responsible for modifications, and these very modifications leads into the species specific morphological distinctiveness, and because of that the genetic diversity can also occur. In the same area we can find if we observe a single species in two different localities, maybe because of environmental causes or maybe because of some metabolic processes, there is some variations in the species composition, and that is covered under the genetic diversity. The simple example is that we are human being, and we human being have no two individual of human are similar. There are some changes in the features, morphological features of human being also, and the same is applicable to the plant species. And the third important component, that is ecosystem diversity. So as we know, there are different types of ecosystem, maybe terrestrial ecosystem or aquatic ecosystem. In aquatic ecosystem, they are further classified as freshwater ecosystem and marine ecosystem or ocean ecosystem. And the freshwater again classified as lentic and lotic type of ecosystem. So these are different types of ecosystems. The morphological, geomorphological features of all these different ecosystems are different, and that is why they are supporting different types of plant species. On the basis of that, the plant species or the number of species in the particular ecosystem may be varied, and they show diversity. Now these variations or this diversity may be in the plant, in the animal, or maybe in the all types of species which are the component of food chain of that particular ecosystem. As an example, if we consider the forest as an ecosystem, and in the forest ecosystem we can find different types of large trees. These large trees supports different types of even the lichen, the epiphytes, the different types of fungi. So the forest ecosystem is comparatively rich in biodiversity with different types of species. Even if we consider a single plant species in the forest, these plant species is supporting different types of animals, different types of birds, then types of insects. So through these different types of interaction, the ecosystem may shows diversity or may shows the variation. So these are the three types of ecosystems, three types of diversity. Species diversity, genetic diversity, and the ecosystem diversity. Now we come to the last part of the last component of this chapter, that is concept of endemism. Now this is a most interesting word, endemism. So this endemism refers to confinement in a particular region. For example, some species we can observe, these species are particularly located in that particular region. For example, the species like Cirrhopegia, the common species which are reported by Shivaji University Kolhapur, Dr. Yadav sir from Shivaji University Kolhapur, and this species Cirrhopegia is located in the restricted in particularly in the Western Ghat region. So this is the Western Ghat region, is the area which is called to which we call that Cirrhopegia is endemic to that particular region. So it is the confinement of particular species, genus or group of plant or animal in the particular area. So we also know that some areas are reserved, maybe the tiger reserve, maybe for reserve area for rhinoceros. In our area also the reserve for deer. So this particular areas where that particular species can be found is the endemic species. And the taxa occurring only a single restricted geographical area. Now that particular species is restricted only to that particular region. Endemism is simply the species which are restricted in distribution in that particular area. And it is normally applied where there is considerable restriction. So this considerable restriction, that means the species, we can find any particular species in that particular region only. For example, maybe if we get one species which is common or which is located in Baramati, so endemism for that particular species. So that particular species is endemic to Baramati region, we can say like that. They are located in distribution because of their narrow ecological amplitude. Now this ecological amplitude is something different. So species have a particular range for different types of abiotic components, maybe temperature, maybe rainfall, maybe wind velocity. So there are certain number of ecological characteristics, and that particular species may have some particular or narrow ecological range, and that is why the species is restricted in the particular region. They lack potential to migrate. This species does not have the abilities to migrate. So when they are restricted in particular region, we can also say the example of Kaas plateau, where we can find number of species, and some of the species on Kaas plateau are endemic to Kaas region or endemic to Kaas plateau. Because they are not able to migrate from the region, so they restricted in that particular region. Real endemics never migrate. If the species is endemic or true endemic, it will never migrate, and new endemics have potential to migrate. So this is what is the concept of endemism. And the last point for today's this session is phytogeography. This is a particularly interesting part because India is considered as the origin of several plant species, and this origin is because of particularly the phytogeographic region or phytogeographic variability we have in India. Now this term phytogeography is something common term. Phyto, that is plant, and geographia, it is geography, or it is botanical geography, and is branch of biogeography that is concerned with geographic distribution of plant species and their influence on the earth surface. So phytogeography, in phytogeography we can study the distribution or the number of different types of species and their distribution in particular region. It covers all aspects of plant distribution, from control of distribution to individual species. Now, depending on this phytogeography, in India, the phytogeographic regions are 9 phytogeographic regions are there. So, Deccan Plateau is there, Malabar region is there, Indus Plain is there, Gangetic Plain is there, Assam, Eastern Himalaya, Central Himalaya, Western Himalaya, and Western coast of India. If we look at all these regions, we can find these regions are different in their geomorphological structures, and because of the different geomorphological structures, the species composition in that different regions is quite different. So Deccan region, then Malabar region, Indus Plain is the region of MP and UP, then Gangetic Plain, the region of Ganga river, then Assam, Eastern Himalaya, Central Himalaya, Western Himalaya, and Western coast of India. So these different regions have different morphological structures, different type of species composition, and that is why on the basis of that the phytogeographic regions are classified. These different regions also have different types of species composition because the ecological structures of this area are different, and that is why they are supporting different types of plant species.